Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of The Fallen Crown by Griff Hosker, narrated by Malk Williams. Prologue. Stockton Castle, January 1140. It had taken us 2 weeks to travel north to our home on the Tees from the lands of the west controlled by Empress Matilda and her half-brother, Earl Robert of Gloucester. It had been a frozen land that became increasingly covered with a blanket of snow the further north we went. It was a journey fraught with potential danger. There were still supporters of the Empress in the land through which we passed, but most of the knights, lords, and magnates were her enemies. We chose the castles in which we stayed wisely. We passed through old trails and forests as we avoided the scrutiny of Stephen the Usurper's supporters. Had there been any brave enough, then we might have encountered bandits, for we carried back the fruits of our victory. We had horses, weapons, mail, and coin. The war in which we had fought had given us knights for ransom, as well as the goods and horses of the dead we had slain. However, my banner was well known, and any bandit knew that an attack on the Warlord of the North would result in but one thing: death. We rode north and were unmolested. The journey back afforded me the time to reflect on the last months of the old year. I had advised the Empress that I would stay away from her court in Gloucester. She had not wished me to do so, but I did not want any hint of scandal associated with the Empress. Her brother suspected that I was the father of young Henry Fitz-Empress, her son. We could not have that suspicion. The Empress's husband, Geoffrey of Anjou, still prosecuted the war on her behalf in Normandy. A hint of scandal might tear our fragile alliance apart. The Empress's forces would consolidate the land around Worcester and Gloucester. I would stay in my northern fortress. True, I was surrounded by enemies, but none frightened me. I had beaten them all. If they came again, then I would defeat them. I had a small retinue, but all of my men were renowned fighters, and they fought for me. Each was worth 5 I might hire in the markets. When I had reached my castle and our goods had been stored, I realized that I was alone. My son and my grandson were in Normandy, and the woman I loved was separated from me by my enemies. I had my men and I had my land, but as I looked out on a frozen River Tees, I felt my isolation more acutely than ever. I had my men-at-arms, and they were like brothers to me, and I had my squires, but I still had to rule the land of the Tees for my Empress alone. I had no one with whom I could consult. If I made the wrong decisions and we lost it, then the floodgates would be opened. The Scots would pour across the river and devastate the land. Had we not held them back at Northallerton, at the battle they called the Standard, barely 2 years ago, then this land would now be Scottish. The effect of that last invasion was still clear for all to see. Ruined castles had still to be rebuilt. There were manors without lords, and without the people to work the fields. I had parlous few lords I could appoint to do so, and the lack of a lord meant a lack of revenue. This war cost money. The Palatinate of Durham was ruled by the Scottish puppet William Cummin, and Prince Henry, the son of King David of Scotland, was now Earl of Northumbria, and he ruled the land north of mine. I roused myself. I had been taught by my father not to waste time worrying about what I could not do. I had money now, and I would use it. I would summon my steward and my mason. We would rebuild the north, one castle at a time. Chapter 1. The Land of the Warlord. That winter seemed to last forever. In some ways that helped us, for although we could do nothing about my castles, the smiths in my towns were able to produce more mail and armour for my men. We used the spare labour we had to help my smith, Alf, and his men at their forges. It took skill to forge a sword, but only muscle was needed to work the bellows. My squires now had full hauberks. All of my men-at-arms wore mail and had fine helmets. The armories had swords and spears aplenty. My fletchers produced the hundreds of arrows my archers needed, and we bred more horses. My men-at-arms and the men of my manor trained. When I went to war, it was the burghers of Stockton and my small garrison which would defend my walls. I had used an idea from the east where I had been brought up. Instead of a mighty wall running all the way around my land, I had a ring of castles and fortified manors. Each could be defended against a smaller enemy, but if we were invaded, then they would garrison the jewel in the crown, Stockton. It was one of a handful of powerful castles which could withstand a prolonged siege. Durham, Bamborough, Barnard Castle and York were the others. The ice and snow did not stop me from venturing to Norton, where Ere guarded my northern frontier, nor Normanby in the east. Barnard Castle and Hugh of Gainford protected the west, and in the south lay Sir Richard of Yarm. With Hartburn, Thornaby, and Elton close by, we felt safe. I knew that could not last. The Scots had been quiet for over a year, and soon they would make another attempt to enlarge their land at our expense. When the first grass was seen after the snows and the ice, I summoned my knights to my hall. I had sent Captain William and my ship, Adela, to Anjou. My son had his own manor now. He was Baron of Ouistreham, but Sir Lefric was the constable of my manor of La Flèche. It was a rich manor in Anjou, and the riches we had collected would allow us to buy that which we could not produce. It also provided men-at-arms for us. We were not reliant on those who had been brought up in England. When I saw the new grass, it meant we could think about going to war once more. My knights arrived for my council of war. This was the first time they had all been together since we had returned from our campaign in the west. Not all had been with me. I had left most at home guarding my land, and they were full of questions for each other. I did not mind the noise and banter. I sat back with a goblet of Angevin red and enjoyed it. Whilst apart, they were bastions and held the line. When they were together, they were a force to be reckoned with. We had a combination of superb archers and doughty men-at-arms. Wielded wisely and well, we were an unstoppable force. Our enemies had discovered that. Even when we were outnumbered, we emerged victorious. My detractors said it was because I was lucky. They were wrong. I thought about warfare more deeply than they did. I had studied at the Emperor's school in Constantinople, and I had read of leaders from the past. I knew how Alexander, Hannibal, and Caesar had fought. I had seen Justinian's walls and spoken to those who kept many times their numbers of barbarians at bay with well-armed and well-led soldiers. I tried to copy that. The only one of my enemies who came close to thinking as I did was my nemesis, the usurper, Stephen of Blois. He was a clever general, and he was popular with his men. He also had more honour than Prince Henry of Scotland. That made him harder to defeat. I was aware that the noise had stopped, and they were all staring at me. Dick, formerly the captain of my archers and now titled Sir Richard, looked concerned and said, "My lord, does something bother you? You have a frown on your brow." I realized that I had been deep in thought. That was the problem with being alone so much. It made a man brood. I stood and smiled. "Forgive me, my friends. I keep alone too much. Now that we are all joined, then nothing worries me. John, have Alice bring in the food. Please, sit. Choose your own places. You know we are not precious about that." I knew that some earls, such as Richard of Gloucester, liked to reward their men by allowing them to sit closer to them. That was not my way. We were all equals, and they chose their companions. Ere, Wulfric, and Dick sat together with Edward. They had all been lowly men until I had elevated them and made them knights. Tristan, Hugh, Harold, John, and my squires sat together. They were the young bloods. and Sir Richard of Yarm sat between me and his son. I had invited Father Henry, the priest of my manor, too, and he chose to sit on the other side of me. Aidan and his two hawkers, Edward and Edgar, had been hunting, and we had a fine deer. Along with the other delicacies which Alice had procured, we ate well. My lands in Anjou ensured that we had better wine than any in England. The feast was convivial. When the plates had been cleared and we nibbled on the sweetmeats served by Alice, talk turned to the civil war which raged.
"So, my lord, do we head south to join with the Empress and the Earl? Do we drive Stephen back to Blois?"
Wulfric was blunt. He spoke the way he fought, directly.
"Would that it were that easy, my friend. Twixt here and Gloucester lie a sea of enemies. I promised the Empress that I would await her commands, and as yet she has not sent me word. The day will come when we join forces, but for the moment she and the Earl consolidate what we won in the autumn and winter."
Sir Edward of Thornaby was a wise warrior.
"Do not be so ready to leave this valley, Wulfric. The Scots look for weakness."
Sir Hugh of Gainford, who was the constable at Barnard Castle, nodded.
"My men have caught and hanged 4 Scottish spies this winter. They probe and they watch. Balliol wishes his castle to be returned to him."
"I know, and that is why you are my rock in the west." "Then we just wait, lord."
Wulfric craved action. For him, a castle was somewhere warm to spend the winter. Now it was getting on for spring, and he was keen to fight.
"Do not worry, Wulfric. If you have a stout garrison and constable, then when we do go to war, you shall be on my right hand as ever."
His grin showed me that I had pleased him.
"I will have men to garrison by the time Adela returns, my lord."
Sir Harold had his own manner of heartburn, but in these uncertain times his family lived with me in my castle, for he just had a hall. I liked the arrangement. His wife and children made me remember my family when they were growing up. Sir Tristan's family did the same at Yarm. Elton and Hartburn did not have castles, and the fortified halls were not strong enough to defend with the Scots on the rampage. It was these who looked at each other, and then Harold spoke for them both.
"We too would come to war with you, lord. We know our families are safe here."
I nodded.
"Sir Edward?"
Laughing, he said, "I am not too old to go to war, lord. Besides, you will need someone to keep this wild berserker in check."
He nudged Wulfric in the ribs. Wulfric feigned innocence.
"Just because I am fearless in battle, there is no need to insult me."
We all joined in the laughter, for when Wulfric had the smell of battle in his nostrils, there was no holding him back. He would charge into any number of enemies, wielding his war axe. His squires did not last long.
"Then I have my Conroy. I would Sir Hugh Manningham was with me, for he is a doughty warrior, but he is the only knight who is north of here on whom I can rely."
Philip of Selby said,
"Then I will be with you and Sir Richard. We are your mounted archers."
"You are. You have proved time and again how you can turn a battle when all seems lost, and to that end I have an errand for the two of you."
They both leaned forward expectantly.
"Philip, I would have you visit with your uncle, the Archbishop. It is some time since we spoke. I would have you gauge the mood of York."
"Aye, lord. It will be good to see the old man again."
"Dick, I need you to risk the high country and visit with the Empress. I will not trust my plans to letters. They can be intercepted. She knows you and can trust your words. I will give you a message for her."
Sir Edward asked,
"Not her brother, lord?"
"The Earl has yet to commit fully to our cause, and he has little love for me at the moment. The Empress commands the army, and it is her orders I shall obey."
"And when do we leave, lord?"
"Tomorrow. That will give us a month to prepare for a campaign. A word of warning, Dick. Steer clear of the land around Chester. That treacherous Earl changes sides every time the wind blows."
"I will."
With our plans made, my knights spoke of horses and castles. They talked of men-at-arms they had trained. Sir Edward's son was now a squire, and he too was full of the promise his son betokened. His words were fulsome and proud as he spoke of his family.
I was a man-at-arms, lord. Had you not elevated me, I would be one yet. But my son is the son of a noble.
He hesitated.
When I fall, will he have the manor?
If it is in my power, then I. That may be in hands other than mine.
He nodded. If we lost this civil war, then all of my knights might lose their manors. Choosing the wrong side could be disastrous. Father Henry took his leave after the last of the sweetmeats had gone. He had listened more than he spoke.
Pray to stay, father.
No, my lord. Your men are warriors and would talk of war.
I do not mind that, but I fear they would be inhibited by my presence. Besides, I have to be up early in the morning for matins.
As you wish. Thank you for coming.
He nodded. Despite what your enemies say about you, lord, you are a good man.
I see that in your deeds around the manor, not on the battlefield. I know not who is right in the matter, the king or the empress. I know that this anarchy is bad for the country. But I am happy that I live here on this island of peace. The people prosper and they are happy. I am their shepherd and they are my flock. That is all a priest can ask.
And you are a good man.
I try. Our church prospers. Each year William the Mason makes some improvement. The avenue of yew trees we planted has lasted well this winter. It will be some time before your men can make bows from their branches, but they are a fine avenue and help to shade the graveyard.
You are the shepherd of men, father. You watch over their souls. I plan for the future. My son and my grandson will be here long after I am gone. They will thank me for the yew trees and the bows they produce.
He smiled sadly.
They will thank you for much more than that, lord.
Pray do not give us the memory too soon.
After he had gone, I reflected on his words. He was right. I had challenged Stephen to single combat.
I was the Empress's champion, but he had refused. He was a good knight at the tourney, but he knew I had never been beaten. Had I had a lesser reputation, we might have settled this conflict with no loss to the people. They were the losers. Bands of knights and vagabonds roamed the land, raiding, raping, and stealing, either in the name of Stephen or Matilda. In truth, they served neither. Knights like Sir Miles Fitzwalter, Sir Payne, Brian Fitzcount, and Sir Geoffrey Talbot were true knights. They served the Empress well. As for the others... The wine flowed freely, and my knights were replete. None ventured forth, and they slept where they could. The company had put me in good humour. The morbid black humour of January had gone. Perhaps it was winter that made me feel that way. I had a grandson I had never seen, and a son who had grown up and become a man without me knowing. My other son I could never acknowledge. One day he would be King of England, and I would bow my knee to him. I knew his mother would never tell him that I was his father. The fate of England, Normandy, and Anjou lay in his hands. We would have to take that secret to our graves. My head and my heart were filled with secrets. I saw them each night when I closed my eyes. They weighed heavily upon me. After they had gone, I sent for my two squires. Gilles was the son of one of my archers who had died in Normandy, and Richard had been the squire of Sir Ralph Buxton, whom I had slain. They had both proved to me that they would make fine knights, but that day was some way off. They were still learning. Both had killed men, but they were not yet ready to be in the line which charged. They needed more muscle to carry the armour that they would need. However, they both needed a better sword. I took them to see Alf. He was the smith in the town, and, along with Ethelred the merchant, was one of the most important men in the manor. He was also the most loyal. A fierce warrior with an axe, he would fight alongside my Frisians to defend the town if enemies came. The clang of his hammer told me that he was working.
His smithy was close to the river. He needed water to temper the steel, and it needed to be away from other buildings. The danger of fire was too great. One of his many sons ran to fetch him as we approached. He stepped from his smithy, red and sweating. Even though the days were still cool, his furnace was, as ever, red hot.
"Yes, my lord."
"I would have you make a good sword for my two squires. They both have one, but they need one made by Alf of Stockton." He bowed at the compliment. He pointed at some shafts of iron that were laid on a table just outside the smithy.
"They're sword blanks. I pray you each lift them. When you find one that is just a little too heavy to lift over your head with your right hand, then fetch it to me."
As they went, I said,
"Too heavy?"
"Yes, lord. They will become stronger, for they are young men. They will grow into their swords. If they were fully grown, then I would not use this method. When I have fitted the guard and the pommel, each weapon will be better balanced."
They both came back with their pieces of iron. Alf nodded and took a piece of rag. He tore it in three. He tied one piece to Richard's blank and two pieces to Gilles'.
"You young masters should come here at the end of each day to see the progress of your blades."
Richard, who was the youngest, asked,
"How long will they take?"
"As long as they need. You do not hurry a sword. His lordship's sword has never let him down. Each smith puts part of himself in every sword he makes. For those who serve the Earl of Cleveland, it must be the best. You will have to be patient."
He pointed to swords in various stages of manufacture.
"The blade has to be hammered and tempered. It must be balanced. See those? They are almost ready for their point, and these for sharpening. Finally, they will have the pommel and the guard fitted. You, young masters, will help in that process. These swords are for sale in the markets of Anjou and Normandy."
As we headed back to my castle, Gilles asked,
"Did your former lord not have a sword made for you, Richard?"
Richard shook his head.
"I was the one who fetched and carried for the others. The sword I offered to the Earl was the one I took from the field."
I remembered that day. I had made a good decision to spare his life and accept the offer of his sword. "And when you are full grown, then we shall visit with Alf again and have your mail made. For the present, that which you wear will have to do. Now, go and tend to Rolf and your horses. We ride at the end of the week. I would see how my people fare. Make sure that all is well. Check every piece of leather and groom all the horses well."
"Aye, lord."
I sought John, my steward. He was less parsimonious since the last attack by the Scots. He had realized that the coins I had used on weapons, mail, and the castle were well spent. Some men built fine castles to make a statement. They told the world that they were important. My castle was not like that. It served one purpose: to protect the Tees Valley and my people.
"When the Adela docks, I want her turned around as quickly as we can, John. We need more men from Anjou."
The Normans and the French were not as good natural bowmen as those we had in Wales and in England. Griff of Gwent attempted to reverse that by training any likely archers. There were many good men-at-arms, and Brian and Pordrig made sure that any they sent were good warriors.
"Aye, lord, and I have a list of things which we need. We will need to build a larger bread oven. The one we have cannot keep up with the demand."
I pointed to the outer bailey.
"There is room aplenty by the river wall. It is safer there, too."
"I will get the men to build it immediately. And there is something else, lord. The mill is not producing as much flour as we need."
The mill was by the manor of Norton. It was inconvenient having to transport it by cart along the Greenway.
"Any suggestions?"
"Father Henry said he had seen a mill at an abbey he visited. They had dug a leat from the river so that they could divert the river to power the mill. It saved them having a mill pond."
He pointed upstream.
"There would seem to be a good place."
"Ask for the father's advice. I think it is a good idea. If we are besieged again, it will save us being cut off from our mill." "And we have goods aplenty to send and sell in Anjou?"
"We have. The tanners have produced much leather, and the women are adept at making many things from it.
The wool we produce, too, is much sought after. The potters are getting better, and one day we can sell our own pots and tiles made from the clay of Stockton.
Good. I shall visit my manors this week. I will hold sessions the week after. Have all the cases I need to hear ready for then and be ready to collect the taxes.
He nodded. Those tasks brought in an income. He liked them.
Next month I expect to take a Conroy south. I wish everything to be ready. Servants, tents, horses, weapons and food. I rely on you, John.
I know, sir, and I will not let you down.
On the morrow I will take a tour of my land.
He already knew that I was leaving a healthy garrison. He had no fears there. My chores were done, and I retired to my solar. I had had a busy morning. Alice would have placed my jug of wine, bread, cheese, and ham there already. She knew my habits. I enjoyed looking south and west from my window. I felt I could see all the way to Gloucester and Matilda. My lady and I knew we were fated never to be together, but it did not stop me from dreaming. As with all such fantasies, it led me to try to come up with a strategy to defeat Stephen once and for all. Had the Earl of Gloucester not been so arrogant, we might have joined forces after we captured Lincoln and defeated Stephen of Blois. He had been weak then. The moment had slipped away, and now we were having to claw back land lost in his campaign. The defection of the Earl of Chester had changed everything. I left my castle before either Philip of Selby or Dick returned. I was not worried. Both were clever men and would not be caught. Better that they take their time and gain valuable intelligence than come back too soon with ill-founded news. I took just my squires and 10 men-at-arms. I was not travelling far, but with the bandits and brigands who abounded once I left my valley, it was as well to be prepared. I would travel to Gainford, and thence to Barnard Castle. Sir Hugh had a castellan at his manor. He held Barnard Castle for the Empress, and one day he would return to Gainford. He had had William, my mason, build him a fine gatehouse in Barbican. He still had a castle with wooden palisades, but little by little he was improving it. Spring in England, especially the north, was unpredictable. When we set out, it was as though winter had returned. A chill wind hurtled in from the north and was in our faces for the first few miles. It was only when we turned just before Yarm that we managed to get a little respite. The wind made conversation impossible. That was probably just as well, for I had much on my mind. Sir Hugh was a fine knight, but I had given him a task which was almost impossible. His nearest aid, should he be attacked, would come from his small garrison at Gainford. It would take a rider almost half a day to reach my castle, and even if we left straight away, he would have to hold off an enemy for at least a day. His castle was well built and had a curve in the river for protection, but he did not have a large number of men to defend the walls. I hated leaving him alone while I went to fight for the Empress. After halting for some refreshments and a warm at the fire in Gainford Castle, we pushed on to Barnard Castle. The approach from the east was deceiving. The castle seemed to have no natural defences. It was only when you tried to get around the castle that you saw how formidable they really were. That was Hugh's problem. The river could be forded or even bridged, and once he was besieged, then an enemy could overwhelm him. He greeted us at his gate. His men had spied my banners coming from some distance away.
Good to see you again, Lord. I will have rooms prepared for you and your squires.
Thank you. I thought Stockton was cold, but here it is even colder, and I am sure I felt a few flecks of snow.
He laughed.
You did, Lord.
I turned to my squires.
See to the horses, and then join me in the great hall.
As squires, the care of the horses was second only to their duty to protect me. His wife bobbed a curtsy.
It is good to see you, my lord. I have had mulled wine prepared, and there will be hot food soon. I will go and hurry the servants.
I smiled.
Not on my account, dear lady.
I need little in the way of comfort these days.
She smiled. Nonetheless, Lord, I would not be showing you the proper respect if I did not.
We sat before his roaring fire.
How goes the work on your defences, Sir Hugh?
I have made devices to pour oil and boiling water from my walls. We have laid in great supplies of pig fat. I know that is the best deterrent.
And how will you keep them from your walls?
I am loath to improve a castle which may be returned to that traitor Balliol. I will not give him a drawbridge, but we now pull in the bridge each night. I keep scouts and hunters in my woods. If Scots or strangers are seen, then we pull up the bridges straight away.
Good. But remember, I am but a day away.
It seems to me that you were in a good position to hold off an enemy for a few days at least. He hesitated.
Speak, Sir Hugh. You know me better than that.
When you are away, Lord, as I know you must, then who will come to my aid?
It was a good point.
Sir Ere and Sir Richard are both well placed to come to your aid. If the enemy was the Scottish army, then all would retire to my castle anyway. I would say send to Durham, but I fear that is full of enemies too.
I will have to pray that Sir Hugh and Sir Ere can reach me in time, then.
He sounded resigned to his fate. I drank some of the mulled wine. It tasted good. I came to a decision.
I will also leave Philip of Selby and his archers. They are well mounted, and if they reached you before an attacker, then I am confident you could hold off the Scots. Do not forget the men who live in this valley have no love for the Scots. Their lord, Balliol, might, but not his people. Use them on your walls. We have shown before that doughty folk using slings and bows can defeat mailed warriors.
My squires returned, and we spoke of other things.
Think you that this is the year the tide will turn for the Empress, Lord?
I hope so, but I confess that I do not have enough knights to force the issue. The Empress and I are dependent on the Earl of Gloucester.
Why does he not support the Empress more than he does?
That was a very good question.
I am not certain, but in my dealings with him over the years, I have seen that he sees himself as his father's son. He can never be king, but he seeks power. He seeks a throne.
He has one now. It is in the west of England. He has conquered large parts of Wales, yet that is a poor country.
I shook my head, for I could not understand the strategy.
If he conquered more of the south and the east, then he would have even greater revenue.
I realized I had become heated. My squires looked fearful, but Sir Hugh smiled.
Fear not, Gilles and Rich. Your lord is a passionate man. He fights for this country, and has a greater vision than any other I have met. It is why we all serve him.
The doors of the hall swung open, and servants appeared with trays laden with food.
Your men are eating with the men-at-arms, my lord. They have fine fare too.
Thank you, mistress. Now pray come and sit by me. I would hear about your children.
I was regaled with tales of their young family, and it made me think about the young family I had never seen, my sons. I decided to head home through Durham, and we left before dawn.
I had not seen Geoffrey Rufus for some time, nor had I heard from him. He had not been the bishop his appointment had promised. Most of that was the fault of William Cumin, his secretary. He was in the pay of the Scots. It meant that the bishop neither supported nor opposed the Empress. He had to tread a fine line between appeasing the Scots and upsetting me. If I was going away, then I needed him to guard my northern borders, or at least warn me of Scottish incursions.
We passed through empty villages as we headed east. In some lay bodies, decayed and eaten by animals in open view. It was desolate.
Where we did see life on distant farms, the sight of my horsemen drove the people within to bar their doors.
Had I had time, then I would have investigated, but time was pressing. The days were still short. The city of Durham had always been prosperous. It was the jewel in the northern crown, and yet, as we headed through the outskirts, I saw few people, and those I did see were fearful and scurried away as we passed. As we neared the walls, I said,
Richard, unfurl the banner.
My 10 men-at-arms were led by Wilfred. As we neared the walls, he said quietly,
I like this not, my lord. Is this safe?
I know not, Wilfred, and like you, I am cautious. Keep your eyes open. I shall just take Gilles with me. If we are admitted, then I will speak with the bishop. If we are not admitted, then that tells us much. I do not intend to stay long. Keep your eyes and ears open.
We will, my lord.
The gates were closed. That was not a surprise. The land was on a war footing. A face appeared at the battlements. I had taken off my helmet, and my hands were not close to my weapons. I came in peace.
I am the Earl of Cleveland, and I would speak with the bishop.
The two guards looked at each other. Their heads disappeared, and then reappeared. One shouted,
The bishop is not a well man. It is said he is close to death.
Then all the more reason that I speak with him.
There was a hurried conference, and the two men left. I turned to Wilfred.
Watch for treachery.
My men were the finest men-at-arms in the land. Each was equipped as a knight. All had a full mail hauberk, good swords, and the best of helmets. More than that, they could think for themselves. There were just 10 of them, but I would back them against 50 others.
Aye, lord.
He turned to Richard.
And you, Master Richard, you keep tight hold of that banner, and if I say move, then stick closer to me than my horse's saddle.
Wilfred was a rough and ancient soldier. He had lost teeth and had scars. I saw Richard nodding fearfully.
Aye, Wilfred.
Eventually, the doors groaned open. The two men we had seen waved us through. I saw a knot of men-at-arms waiting by the keep. I saw no priests. I glanced around the walls. They were manned, but not heavily.
Where was the garrison?
If this was all that the bishop had to defend his walls, then the Scots could walk in any time they chose. We stopped, and I handed my reins to Oswald and my helmet to Richard. My shield hung from Rolf's side. A sergeant-at-arms gave a slight bow.
I command the garrison, lord. I am Ralph of Rothbury.
I had not met the man before, but he was a powerful-looking warrior. Rothbury had been English and was now Scottish. This man could have allegiances on either side.
I hear the bishop is ill.
He nodded.
The priests are with him.
Then take me to him.
He hesitated.
I am not certain that is a good thing, my lord.
I looked him in the eyes.
Know you that I am the warlord of the north?
He nodded.
I led the armies of the north when we defeated King David at Northallerton, and I have a warrant from Empress Matilda to rule in her stead. Would you disobey me?
He looked around. Someone else was making decisions here. He quailed.
He is in the chapter house.
I know where that is.
I did not add that I had recaptured this castle from enemies before.
Wilfred, watch the horses. Come, Gilles.
As we strode across the green to the chapter house, I said quietly,
I rely on you to watch my back.
Aye, lord.
His hand went to his sword. I entered the chapter house and surprised a young priest, who turned around with a startled expression on his face.
I am the Earl of Cleveland. Where is the bishop?
Unlike the sergeant-at-arms, the priest looked happier to see me when he heard my name.
Come with me, lord. It is good that you have come.
As he led me through a corridor, I asked,
Trouble?
The dean will tell you all.
He shrugged.
I am but a novice, my lord. You need to know facts, not what a young priest has gleaned.
I smiled. I liked this young and earnest man.
What is your name, priest?
I am Brother Thomas, sir, from Leyburn.
You are an honest man. My castle always welcomes such men.
He nodded. I knew we were close to the bishop's quarters when I began to smell death. It hung in the air and lay like a fog in the Tees Valley. If the bishop was not already dead, then he would be before too long. An older priest stood as we entered the chamber. I turned to my squire. Gilles, go back to the chapter house door and keep watch. He glanced around the room and I smiled. I am safe here. These are men of God and we can trust them. He left. The dean said, Not all men of God are to be trusted, my lord. I am William of Arundel, the Dean of Durham. I looked at Geoffrey Rufus. He lay still and white, looking like a piece of marble. How is the bishop? He clings on to life by a thread. What is the illness? The young priest and the dean looked at each other. Speak! The dean said, I think he was poisoned. He was hale and hearty a week since, and then he woke one morning vomiting. We gave him purgatives and water, but I think the deed was done by then. Has he woken? Sometimes he opens his eyes, but we have heard no words these last 3 days. I went to the bed and touched the bishop's hand. It was still warm, but only just. I could feel his heart beating in his wrist, but it was painfully slow. As I held it, I said, I saw empty villages and dead bodies. Was this the Scots? I heard the dean say, The Scots have not visited their wrath on us these last 2 years, not since the battle. I took that in as I looked down at the man on whom King Henry had placed such faith. And the garrison, it seems a little smaller than it used to. His words were guarded. They are riding abroad. And who leads them? There was another pause, and before the dean could answer, the bishop's eyes opened.
My lord, you have come. God has answered my prayers.
His voice was weak, but I saw the spark of life in his eyes. I have come. His claw-like fingers gripped my hand as though he was clinging onto life. He pulled my arm down towards him. I lowered my head.
I have not long for this world. I am at peace, for I have no more sins, for I have confessed.
I did not know if he was talking to me or to God.
I have been poisoned. It is cumin. You were right in your suspicions. He is in the pay of the Scots.
The effort of speaking was too much, and he sank back into the bed. His hand fell to his side. I turned. Where is Cumin? The dean said, In the great hall. He commands here now.
And his men?
They are led by his nephew, Osbert.
And they lay waste to this land.
The dean looked helplessly at me and nodded. I felt the bishop's fingers as they tapped on my arm. He did not open his eyes, but he whispered,
Take care of my people, Lord.
Just then, Gilles burst in. Lord, armed men are heading this way from the keep. I turned to the dean.
Stockton will always welcome those who cared for this man. I will have to leave now. I have few men with me, but I shall return.
The dean nodded. I know, Lord. That has always been a comfort. But we are bound to the bishop. So long as he lives, we stay. I pray you to hurry. They mean to trap you. I was drawing my sword, even as I hurried down the corridor.
Gilles, stay close behind me. We must get to the horses.
As we burst from the door, I saw the 8 men-at-arms led by Ralph of Rothbury. They were 40 paces from us and hurried towards us in a column of 2s. Wilfred had seen the danger, and he and 4 of my men rode towards us. They were on the other side of the bailey. I pulled my sword back and ran at the 8 men. They had shields, and we did not. As Ralph of Rothbury swung his sword at me, I grabbed his right wrist and punched him in the side of the head with the hilt of my sword. He was not expecting it, and he fell to the ground. The man behind had not expected that. And when I swung my sword sideways, the blade ripped open his cheek and jaw. I felt a blow to my back, but my mail was well made. I whipped my sword around me in an arc. As I turned, I saw that my sword had bitten into the neck of Ralph of Rothbury, who had attempted to strike my unprotected back. Gilles was pulling his sword from the stomach of another, as Wilfred and my men bundled their horses into the backs of the others. Their swords made short work of them. The alarm bell was ringing. I saw Raymond of Le Mans and Richard galloping towards us as my men finished off the men-at-arms. The walls were filling with men. As I mounted Rolf, I shouted, "The sally port! The gate will be guarded!" I pointed to the small postern gate which lay close to the cathedral. Wilfred nodded. We had used the sally port to gain entry. He waved his arm, and the last of my men galloped towards us. I donned my helmet and hefted my shield. Cumin was a cunning man, and he would know about the sally port. It would be guarded, but not as well as the main gate. I spurred Rolf towards the small gate in the curtain wall. As I had expected, he had men on the walls and four crossbowmen at the gate. Other men were flooding from the keep where they had been hiding. I led, and that drew the bolts. The four all aimed at me. I held my shield across my chest. One pinged off the side of my helmet, and two struck the shield. Cumin was no soldier. If he had been, he would have used archers. It took too long to reload a crossbow. Rolf was fast, and my sword hacked into the neck of one of those with a crossbow as Gilles slashed a second across his back. Wilfred sent two men up the ladders to clear the ramparts, while the rest slew the remaining crossbowmen. Oswald leapt from his horse to open the door. We would have to lead our horses through, and we needed to buy some time.
"Gurth, Leopold of Durstein, with me. The rest of you, get through the gate. Gilles, hold the gate for us."
We did the unexpected. We charged the gaggle of men-at-arms who raced towards us. Leaderless, now that Ralph of Rothbury was dead, they came like a rabble. Rolf had enough space to open his legs. With my shield protecting both my left side and my middle, I leaned forward to scythe sideways at the men-at-arms. They were already trying to get away from Rolf's slobbering jaws and his mighty hooves. The last thing they were watching for was my sword as it hacked through necks, backs, and arms. My quick hands struck four blows so quickly that my blade was a blur. I reined him around. It took all of my strength to do so. My two men-at-arms had carved a similar path, and we rode back through the maimed and wounded. The ones who could fled before us. Behind me, from the top of the round keep, I heard William Cumin screaming,
"Kill them! Kill them all!"
Cumin was not a soldier. Had he been, he would have led his men. With their captain dead, his men were reluctant to risk the wrath of the warlord. They were tardy in their advance. We slowed our horses down to calm them and walked them to the sally port. Gilles stood, as I had asked, holding the door open. We dismounted and walked our horses through. On the other side, my men waited on the narrow path which circumnavigated the walls. I had no doubt that the men on the walls would try to shower us with crossbow bolts, but we had our shields. We made the Stockton Road with just one injury. A bolt had managed to penetrate the links on the hauberk of Stephen the Grim. It had barely nicked his leg. We rode home, and I realized that we now had no allies whatsoever north of Barnard Castle and Norton. We were alone. Chapter 2. As we headed south, my wounded man-at-arms was the butt of my men's humour.
"I see the bolt did not make you smile then, Stephen the Grim. Repairing your mail will cost you a coin or two. I saw the bowman if you wish to go back and get him."
He shook his head. It was true he never smiled. He had been wounded in the face, and for some reason he had lost the ability to do so. He had a good sense of humour, and gave as good as he got.
"Fear not, Leopold. I have coin enough. I, unlike you, know how to choose rich knights to fight."
Wilfred rode next to me as they bantered.
"I'm sorry I was so slow reaching you, Lord.
I wondered at the delay. What happened?"
"I see now the ploy. They sent out food and ale. We were distracted."
I suddenly turned.
"You did not partake of either, did you?"
No, Lord, for we saw the men-at-arms moving towards you. Why? In all likelihood, it was poisoned. The bishop is dying, and he believes that Cumin poisoned him.
Curse him for a dissembler and a villain!
He turned and looked back at the walled city.
Does this mean that Durham is now a stronghold of the Scots?
Not yet. He is not bishop. Until he is, then he cannot ally with Scotland. But one of his nephews, Osbert, serves Prince Henry and leads the savages who raid and pillage. Once we reach my home and before we join the Empress, we will rid the Palatinate of this scourge.
Then Sir Hugh is on his own.
I fear so. We will have to leave a stronger garrison in Stockton. This land is more dangerous now than when we set off. We reached my home well before dark. After warning John that I would need to take a Conroy north, I sought Aidan and his falconers. The two youths were now almost...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.